Okay, Psalms 1. Blessed, happy is the man who walks and lives not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the path where sinners walk, nor sits down where the scornful gather, but his delight and desire is in the law of the Lord. And on his law he habitually meditates by day and by night. He shall be like a tree firmly planted by the streams of water, ready to bring forth its fruit in its season. Its leaf will also shall not fade or wither, and everything he does shall prosper. Psalms 92. Let's read that one. All right. God gets glorified when you live in the inheritance that he left you and gave you and paid for you for. It's not just finances. Everything he died for. What did he die for? He gave you a testament. What's the testament? Christ is the heir of all things. Hebrews chapter 1. You are the joint heir with Christ. These things I've said quite often in the past few months, but I want us to hear it, hear it, hear it until we walk away with the inheritance and walk in it. So this is what he will do. This is what his heart is for you. It glorifies God. In fact, the Holy Spirit in the book of Corinthians spoke through Paul as he wrote. Then he wrote it down. Desire to prophesy, desire the gifts, especially to prophesy. All right, so what you must desire it. Everything you receive from God comes and starts with a desire. If you, and the desire must be grounded in God's word and God's will for your life. Otherwise, your desire is grounded in your own selfish ambition and what you want to achieve and do and reach. But if your desire starts, with the word of God and the will of God, that is a holy desire. Are we in agreement? If the word of God stirs the desire, if the word of God says desire to prophesy, and you say, no, you know, I don't want to just want the gifts, I just want Jesus. But the Spirit said desire to prophesy. So you're against the desire of the Spirit. All right, he wants you to desire to prophesy. So everything in the Word of God starts with a desire. You need a desire for those things, and it must be stirred by the actual Word of God. So if no one ever knows what's in the Testament, how will they ever desire the inheritance? But the other deception we had is that inheritance is kept in heaven, and on earth you suffer and die, and then you attain it when you're there. So either the deception of religion was, there's no inheritance for you. Don't think you're so lucky that you're a joint heir with Christ. That's the wrong perspective. We are a joint heir with Christ. I'm just by way of speaking. First deception, don't think you're a joint heir with Christ. Who are you? All right? Second deception, yes, you are a joint heir with Christ, but in heaven. You'll get it there. Okay. But the inheritance was given and someone died. And when he died, he left an inheritance. He gave an inheritance. We need to lay hold of the inheritance. Amen? Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Yes. All right, so let's read Psalms 92 before I continue. So the deception. There's no inheritance for you. You don't qualify for it. It's not really true. The other deception, it's only in heaven for one day. All right. So, but what a Psalms 1 says, if you are a tree planted by the river, you'll bear fruit in your season, and everything you do will prosper. Okay, Psalms 92. The righteous, verse 12, shall flourish, say flourish, like the palm tree You don't have to say that. The righteous shall flourish. And then I read, like a palm tree. Listen to the Amplified. Be long-lived, stately, upright, useful, fruitful. Long-lived, stately, upright, useful, fruitful. The righteous, right? They shall grow like a cedar in Lebanon, majestic, stable, incorruptible. Majestic, stable, incorruptible. Planted. Huh? Planted. Where? In the house of the Lord. What is the house of the Lord? It is the presence of God. It is the presence of God. Surely the house of the Lord and His presence shall be my dwelling place. Psalms 23. What is the river and a tree planted by the river? The river is the presence of God. But it's also the Word of God, because the Word of God carries the presence of God, and the Spirit of God is inside of His Word. So I explained to you, every word that Jesus speaks is Spirit and life. I'll make it very simple. Jesus and His Word is, you can't separate them. He is the Word that became flesh, dwelled among us. All right. So if you plant a tree by the river, you will bear fruit. Every single thing you do will prosper. It's true. The Word. Now, you read that, and some religious little thing in your heart says it's not right to desire to prosper. Hallelujah. All right. The Scripture says, if you're a tree planted by the river, this is what you will have. Everything will prosper. But something in your heart says, it's not right that I desire to prosper. Well, you should desire to be next to the river. First of all, that should be your main desire. But secondly, you should desire to prosper. Healing, for instance, came through the blood of Jesus. Isaiah 53, by His wounds we are healed. Now you should desire to be well. It starts with a desire. I want to be well. He paid for it with His blood. I desire to receive my healing. I desire to receive it. So it starts with the desire from God. The desire from His Word. And then it's encouraging you to desire it in your heart. All right, so let me continue here. Psalms 92, planted by the in the house of the Lord, they shall flourish. Say flourish. God wants you to flourish. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be full of sap and rich in the verdure of trust, love, and contentment. It's a spiritual vitality, full of sap. They are living memorials to show that the Lord is upright and faithful to His promises. Living memorials to show that the Lord is upright and faithful to His promises. He is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in Him. Planted in the house of the Lord. Planted next to the river. Same thing. Same thing. Not difficult. So, what will happen to the one that's planted in the house of the Lord? He shall flourish. Twice it says, flourish, flourish, flourish. Twice it says, we will flourish. And we need to desire those things. We need to know this is the will of God in order for it to manifest. We, in this church and in our lives personally, I can't talk for every person, but our hearts is first of all, just to know Christ and to fellowship with Him. Our hearts are Jesus, not things. Secondly, we want to see the world saved and healed. That's our heart. Thirdly, what God says is ours. We have discovered that when we receive it, it glorifies Him. So, but it's third in line. The rest is already in place for us as a family. If we need to go to China today, we'll pack and leave. If we need to do, we do. What God says, we do, we do. We live for the glory of God. We want to see the soul saved. All right, we want to see the world changed. That's what we do. That's our lives. Sorted. What do we want? Jesus. What else? The world saved. The gospel preached. Thirdly, the word of God is an indication of the things we should desire. Not things we should resist. Things we should argue against or things we should persecute. And so if you're persecuting prosperity, persecuting the word of God. Persecuting healing, persecuting the word of God. Persecuting everything that was paid for by the blood of Jesus and attained by his blood through his death and resurrection, you're persecuting the word of God. So the word of God stands. Persecutions for the word's sake. So that guy wasn't just persecuted. He received so much more than everything he gave away and the persecution as a result of abundance. The Philistines envied Isaac as a result of abundance. You get it? Don't worry. Let me say it like this. There would be no persecution if people do not do anything. You need to go for it and do something. Then there's something to look at and so they envied Isaac. They envied him. Why? Because he was blessed of God. And so the same with everything in the Word of God. We need to desire the things that the Word of God says we can have. The inheritance we have is everything that God is, everything that He has. That's the inheritance. And God wants you to walk. By His stripes you were healed. Now, what glorifies God the moment you are healed? The moment the sick receives healing, it glorifies God. Why? Because He paid for it with His blood. He also paid for you for your peace in all circumstances, your joy. Rejoice in the Lord sometimes, no, always. He gave you the fruit of the Spirit. All of what God is and all that God has. He is a joint heir. We are a joint heir with Christ and He's the heir of all things. God really wants His children to lay hold of their inheritance. They've been deceived in leaving it for heaven. They've been deceived in thinking He's not really happy when they go and say, I receive. Or where they lay hold of it. So the deception is the inheritance, God is keeping it safe for us. Our minds are keeping us away from it. The inheritance, God is keeping it safe for you until you by faith, receive it. Everything, I'll put it in simple words. In Christ, God did everything for you and He wants you to receive the blessing that He paid for with His blood. He wants you to be prosperous. I will use those words in the face of all of this. He wants you to be rich. He wants you to be wealthy. He wants you to be healed. He wants you to be blessed. That health and wealth gospel that people speak against, He wants you to be healthy. I'll repeat. He wants you to be wealthy. He wants you to be blessed. He wants you to walk in all of what He paid for with His own blood. What do you need to do? Make first things first. Priority. We live to know Christ. We want to see the world saved. The only difference between the old covenant and the New Testament, two differences. It's the way we receive from God. It's not God that changed. So if you look at the old covenant and see God blessing Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, too late. I am also an heir of God, joined there with Christ. And if I believe, I'm blessed with the believing Abraham. So if God blessed Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God still wants to bless the righteous. Still wants to bless the righteous. He blessed them. He wants to bless you. The only difference is the way you're going to receive it. The difference is not you shouldn't want it. That is the devil that lied to you. You shouldn't desire it. That is the devil. The difference is not you shouldn't want riches and glory and honor and all of the good things that God paid for in the new. That's not the difference. The only difference is how you will receive it. And how will you receive it in the New Testament? By believing it's yours. By faith. And how will you believe it if people say it's not yours? Faith comes by hearing, and lack of faith comes by hearing religious preaching. So it robs you from getting what God paid for you to have. Because you think it's evil, money is evil. No, the love of money is the root of all evil. What is the love of money? You love money above God. You serve God, money, not God. God says, go and do this. You think, I wonder if I have enough money. So who are you serving? Moses and the blessings of Moses were conditional. The only difference is the way we receive. Faith is the means to receive. In the new, Old Testament obedience was the key to get God to bless you or to get the blessing. This side, faith is the means to receive. The only difference is that the second thing is on this side, we have a great commission that should be in the forefront of every heart of every believer across this world. If we don't live to see the world saved, we are distracted by whatever, including finances. But if we live for souls to be saved, and this is our passion, the money we get will help that thing happen so quickly in the world that we live in today. So if you have a heart to get the world saved, finances can now work for you instead of you working for it. And it can help you fulfill the God-given desires that He has given you. God delights in the prosperity of His servant. The old covenant God is the God of the new. The only difference is the way we receive. The second thing is we have a different mission. A different mission that should be priority. If that is not your priority today, I think deep down, you want to see God's desire fulfilled upon this earth. What is His desire? That every man be saved. That every sick person be healed. That all Christians will become mature in Him, that they can live out and shine their light upon the earth. That's His desire. That is not your desire now. Pray to God that He puts His desires in your heart. That the main desire becomes the main desire. The church must shake off. It's like a rugby player. He needs to now just, you know, he's on his way to the try line. But the enemy has sent his cover defense. The cover defense is coming for you. And the cover defense is to get the church to believe that prosperity is evil and that wanting to live in abundance is not right. And so the cover defense comes. But you're on your way to the dry line. Just shake it off and go on. Shake it off. Just bump it off and keep going. Keep going. Don't stop. Don't even slow down for them. For the persecution. Don't even slow down. Remember, the persecution is religious persecution on the word. I've never talked in our church about persecution, but we do get persecuted every day for what we preach and believe. Really, we do. You know nothing of what we go through for the sake of the truth. Man, people get angry in the name of God. Oh, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. But that's nothing. That's nothing. I don't glory in the persecutions. Paul mentioned it. He said, I've been shipwrecked. I've been done. He says, but none of these things move me. None of these things move me. He says, he actually in another place in Philippians said that I count it all as lost. All my achievements as lost. As nothing for the joy of knowing Him. So he is speaking of his revelation of who God is. Thank you, Lord. That is what we should do and be. Everything into God, into fellowship with God. Think of it. Think of your life. Think of your family. Think of where you're heading. You've laid down the weapons against prosperity. In fact, you now have a curiosity and a heart that says, now I want to hear this more. And then, so now you hear it more. It's going to manifest in your life. Prosperity. It's going to bring forth God's will in that area for your life. You're going to see it coming in. You're going to see that money coming in and no longer think it's an evil thing. It's God's blessing, and God is glorified when you walk in it. When the righteous are blessed, God is glorified. When you walk in your prosperity, God is glorified. You have to understand it's the will of God. You have to understand that part of the curse of the law was poverty. How will God use that? Just hear this. This part of the curse, prosperity is part of the blessing. When people obeyed the law, this side of the blessing is all the good things. This side is poverty, sickness, curses. Who spoke it? God. If you obey, these blessings will come upon you. If you do not obey, these curses will come upon you. Now, how did those things that were curses in the old covenant become good things? How did they transform into a blessing? The blessing of poverty. The blessing of sickness. No! Sickness, poverty is not the nice. It's not nice. It affects our lives negatively. And even if we are sick and we are poor, God loves us the same. And I have eternal redemption in God. Like Paul and Silas didn't praise God only when they were blessed and favored and the doors opened and the ministry opened and they were changing the city. No, they praised God in jail. If we make the main thing, I think it puts the message that I preach today in its rightful place. But if we have not the main thing, the moment the money is not there, we start blaming God, or we draw back because we think it didn't work. You know, I've been trusting God for this person to be healed and they did not get healed. Or if I've not seen the prosperity, I haven't seen it. Now we move away from God. Why? Because the main thing is not the main thing. That's red lights. Woo-hoo-hoo. But that doesn't make that thing evil. It's you having the wrong thing first. Seek first the kingdom of God and these things. If you can just hear it, let's go to 1 Corinthians. But on the contrary, verse 9, the scripture says, what the eye has not seen, the ear has not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man, all that God has prepared, made and keeps ready for those who love Him. Hallelujah. Don't stop there. Amen. I have not seen, ear have not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those who love Him. Amen. No, amen there. Keep reading. Yet to us, God has unveiled and revealed them by His Spirit. All right? What did He reveal? He revealed those things that the eye have not seen, the ear have not heard, nor has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared. He revealed them by His Spirit. Then, the favorite verse, you know where I'm heading, verse 12. Now we receive not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit who is from God, I read New King James Version, yeah? That we might know the things that have been freely given to us of God. So, the Spirit of God is revealing constantly things that are freely given of God. Notice the word things there. That things are not evil, because Jesus said, if you seek the kingdom first, these things will be added. Now it says in 1 Corinthians 2, that the things that He has prepared for us, the eye have not seen, the ear have not heard, hasn't entered into the heart of man. The things. But God unveiled them, or the inheritance, by His Spirit, that we might know the things that were freely given of God. And He keeps it ready for us. He keeps it safe. God's not holding your inheritance and then, like, here's your inheritance and here's God. Then he looks at your life. He looks at how deserving you are and bless you with something. And he keeps the rest. This is the wrong way, right, children? But bless you. No. Keep the rest. No, he's keeping it safe, not from you, from the enemy, from whoever wants to steal and rob it. It's keeping it safe for you, not from you. So he has it here until faith comes and just lay hold of it. Faith receives. It's faith is the substance of the things we hope for, the evidence of the things we do not see. If faith knocks on the door, God is smiling and thinking, oh, at last, my inheritance can reach its destination. He placed it as you are written there, your inheritance. He desires for you to walk in it. Faith pleases God. Remember Hebrews 11 verse 6? Faith pleases God. Why? Because faith receives. Therefore, it pleases God. When faith receives, God is pleased. Because now the children walks in the blessing that he paid for with his blood. He paid for you. He died for you to be blessed, prosperous, wealthy, rich, extreme. Abraham was extremely rich. Okay. God in his word, it's written down there. Abraham, I'm going to bless you. Then the next chapter. And Abraham was extremely rich. Now, surely if it was evil, it wouldn't even... Maybe God would secretly bless him. That just because he likes Abraham. But now it's written. The man was extremely rich. Me saying that does not make me materialistic. Me not fulfilling the Great Commission and loving Jesus with all my heart makes me whatever, distracted. But if I have Jesus, and you know what is a good indication if someone has their eyes, is they're not religious, they have two things that come with them, peace and joy. You need only one thing. And you have one problem. You have one solution. Problem, faith is not there. Solution, faith must come. Therefore, it comes by hearing. But hearing this message that produces faith. Imagine hearing the message that works against you. Imagine you lose faith every day you go to church. Less faith, less faith, less faith. That's terrible. Less faith than yesterday. I was better off just on Saturday at the cricket field. I was better off. But imagine going to any church where Christ is preached and faith comes by hearing. The word of God comes to your heart. And you go ahead in life. And then you add it, you throw it in the week. And faith comes by hearing. Then you take your Bible and you read your own Bible, spend time with God. Faith comes by hearing and spending time with God in His presence. And you become someone that believes naturally. Carnality is not just this evil carnality of flesh people. No, no. Carnality is, and this is it, living by your five senses. Taste, hear, see, smell. You're not living by faith. The just, how will the just live? By faith. Not by what you taste, see, hear, and smell. You're not living a natural human life. You're living by faith. And that's how the just shall live. That's how the just shall lay hold of the things that God paid for with His own blood. God wants you blessed. He wants you to receive it. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus.